Dr. Roberts joins us. His website is excellent. You can read his syndicated column there, paulcraigroberts.org. His most recent book is titled How America Was Lost. And I have never been in such deep mourning, Dr. Roberts. And I know you've been not cynical, but you know, almost gallows humor laughing about this yourself. I am just struggling with my instinct to get my family out of the country. I've pledged to stay here and try to fight this. I know I couldn't live with myself if I didn't stay, but I know for a fact that they've got the FBI for 2 years digging into me under White House orders. I've confirmed this from people in the government, directly from with agents. And the FBI can't find anything, so they're being ordered now. And I was told, well, new units are going to be created, and they're creating political offices that are going to go after everybody. And now you see what's happening to the polls. And I told people before it was even in the news they were going to indict the attorney general in Texas. You know, I have obviously a lot of high-level sources. I know you have a lot of high-level sources as well. But this really is the breaking of America right now and the long breath before the plunge, in my view, to total totalitarianism. And I think they're probably going to arrest you, too. What do you have to say about that?
Well, I think all of it's possible except the part about the UN. It won't have anything to do with the UN. It certainly won't be managed by the UN.
Well, I'm not saying they're going to run it, but they say under treaty and under agreement. I can show you Associated Press.
It'll have nothing whatsoever to do with the UN.
Okay, well, break it down in your view then what I just talked about.
Well, it'll strike most people as Alex has gone further off the wall. But I do think that we have seen many signs of the police state. In fact, we can say that it was established when the George W. Bush administration announced that it had the right to detain American citizens indefinitely without presentation of evidence or without a warrant, without going to a court. The fact that they got away with that was all you need to know, that there was a police state, because that's strictly unconstitutional. Nothing was done about it. The Justice Department is so totally corrupt. They were having memos written to justify the assumption of dictatorial power by the president, placing his actions above constitutional control. The two parties involved in these memos, one of them is now a professor of constitutional law, the University of California, Berkeley, Bolt School of Law, and the other is a federal judge. So this is all you need to see that it's a police state. The Berkeley Law School took a guy who wrote memos justifying torture, which is strictly illegal under both U.S. law and under international law.
Of course, John Yoo, Alberto Gonzalez, and others just openly said they could even bury people alive, rip their fingernails out, do anything they wanted.
John Yoo wrote the memo, and this other guy, I think, what was his name? Was it Baby or something like that?
Yes, the issue is, though, it was adopted by the government as if it was legitimate.
Well, it was asserted by the Bush administration. And the Department of Justice had these guys write these memos that had no basis in law to justify an assertion of power. And nobody did anything about it. The Congress didn't do anything about it, the courts. So that showed that there was a police state. And of course, then Bush's successor had a chance to correct all that. Instead, he just went further because he added to this assertion of indefinite detention his right to murder U.S. citizens without due process of law.
NDAA.
And proceeded to do so. So I don't think you need any memos or anything else, because that's all the evidence you need that you have a police state. And I think also when you see the continuing murder of unarmed U.S. citizens by the police, who are supposed to be protecting them, and very, very little accountability of the police who commit these crimes, in most cases, nothing happens to them. Then you can see again that American citizens no longer have the protection of law. They're not even safe from their own police. And the police murder and abuse at will, and very, very little, if anything, happens. It's very rare that a police officer is held accountable for his crimes. So I think that's about all the evidence you really need, Alex. And I don't know how.
Well, the point I'm getting to is they are heating it up. They are clearly going after people like Dinesh D'Souza for a speech. They're clearly going after Rand Paul now. They're clearly the persecution is accelerating, and the Justice Department. To be clear, and I have Associated Press right here, I understand that it's not the UN that's going to run it all, but the UN, they're following UN guidelines in a UN initiative on the, quote, hate speech to restrict free speech. So they're claiming that as their authorization to, and as their directive.
Alex, but look, they can claim anything. I just told you, if they can claim that the president is above the law and not subject to constitutional restraint, they can claim anything.
That's what I'm getting at. So I'm saying the fact that they're creating a new anti-terrorism unit and saying they're preparing for this conflagration, obviously we've seen their past activities. What I'm saying is they're moving into a new level of draconian action, in my view.
No doubt about it. I mean, just look at the persecution of whistleblowers. So I think that this is all realistic, and it doesn't need to be understated or overstated. It's just a fact. You know, at the time when Bush made that announcement, he could put Americans under indefinite detention. I said this will be covered up with the claim that he's only doing this to terrorists. But once you breach that, you do it to everybody. I pointed out over and over and over that the law expands to the limits of its logic.
That's right.
And just act like the RICO Act was only to get the mafia. Now it's used in divorce courts.
That's right.
So it's clear it's going to go that way. And the real question is, if they are busy at war with their own people, how are they going to be at war everywhere else, much less with Russia and China? And I think that one of the signs of hope is the two speeches that Obama and Putin gave at the UN on the 28th of September, because the whole world saw that Obama was a stooge, a liar, a deceiver, and that Putin was a statesman who told the truth and stood up. So I think you've seen a sea change in the power in the world. The United States is no longer a unipower. It's a semi-superpower, certainly behind the Russians, probably also behind the Chinese. And so the alteration of the American position in the world, and then look at what's happening to the empire. Look what's happening in Europe. Europe is being overrun with refugees that it doesn't want, has no place for. All because the idiot Europeans enabled Washington's wars in the Middle East. So they've got to be sitting there thinking, what dolts we were. Look what we get for being Washington's vassals. They also now, having seen Russia stand up and simply tell us no. You know, the statement that Putin made was that we can no longer tolerate the state of affairs in the world. That is a declarative sentence. It says, that's it. We're not putting up with anything else. 2 days later, he's taken over the war in Syria. We can't do anything about it. Bluster. So the power in the world has changed.
We've lost our moral high ground.
We've never had it. We've lost the pretense of it.
Yes.
Yeah. We've lost the mask is off. The world looks at us totally different. They say, hey, look, we don't have to be afraid of the bully anymore because we've got the Russians and Chinese standing up to them. And even the Iranians stood up to us. So I think that, you know, how is a country that's beleaguered abroad, whose empire is tottering, is now going to make war on its own people? I believe you're probably right that they intend to do that. But, you know, you go from weakness to weakness.
No, I agree. The good news is they're so discredited, and people in government are pretty upset that I talked to, too. I think the mask is coming off here, and so a lot of this may just be bluster. I mean, it's going to get really obvious if they indict every member of the Tea Party.
It could be. I'm told that today I was told, but, you know, you never know what people tell you. They're trying to plant ideas or stories, or they got an agenda. But I was told today something that sort of surprised me, and that is that there's a tremendous amount of opposition within police forces themselves to this militarization of the police, to these brutal acts, and that the situation is not quite what it looks like on the surface. Now, if this is true...
No, I agree with that.
If this is true, it's good news. Now, if they're going to start indicting attorney generals of Texas and the governor and ruining U.S. senators, people will see that. And you got to remember, too, the polls, Alex. You remember not long ago we saw the poll that 62% of Americans favored a third party. This is brand new. We saw that 75% of Americans thought that government at all levels was corrupt. This is brand new. So if these polls are correct. And so perhaps you've been successful in waking people up.
Well, I think we all have together. You certainly and others get credit. They see the polls as kind of the tip of the spear because they know they're for real as well. But what do you expect, though, with the history of hubris and being in Washington? I mean, obviously, we weren't perfect then, but compared to the Soviet Union, I'd say we were the good guys. And you were there, Reagan, tear down that wall. That did put pressure on the Russians. It did help reform things. And we now see a shift where it's like Putin's like Reagan saying to us, stop being tyrants, and saying, look what you've done in the Middle East, funding ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Shame on you. Just, it's like the emperor's new clothes. Putin really is being a statesman. What do you expect them to do now to try to counter that?
I think the CIA will try to assassinate him. I think Putin's in substantial danger of assassination. That's what I think. I hope he stops walking around the streets unprotected. And no American president can do that. Only Putin.
Well, he's not a coward, that's for sure.
Well, I mean, the people there don't want to kill him. So I think that Putin's in danger of assassination by the CIA or some rogue group. They're probably rogue groups that are far worse than the CIA.
Of course.
And we just don't know about them. And so I think they will continue to persecute whistleblowers. They'll continue to move in the direction that criticism of the government is illegal. And they'll first say, you know, you're a domestic extremist, and they'll find somebody that's easy for people not to like and go along with, and then the next guy will not quite be so easy to dislike, and then finally they'll get whoever they want. That's the way it goes.
Exactly.
So I think that is in motion, but I do think now there's more awareness. I don't know to what agreement they would be able to bring military officers. Some of them I know are useless and rotten and no good, and others have integrity. So it's not a clear open road for them. I think you're right that they're going in this direction, but whether they can pull it off, I don't know. I think they're going to have more problems than they can handle. For example, the economy. I can't really stay the whole hour.
I understand. They told me an hour before. I know you got to go. Can you do 10 more minutes to tell us about the economy?
Yeah, because that's another problem for them. And all of these things can overwhelm them. And I mean, the thing can collapse out from under them. I mean, the economy, you know, look, it's a house of cards. We've talked about it. They've kept it up by creating money to sustain all the bad investments the banks made. But the economy itself is not growing. Retail sales aren't growing. Real consumer incomes are declining. They're going down. There's no basis for the economy to grow. They create the image of success by manipulating the figures and the way they measure unemployment, the way they measure inflation. And so they're trying to create a matrix, an image of success that's not there. The dollar is it's rigged. It's the only way it can stand. It's rigged because the Japanese print to support it, the European Central Bank prints to support it. But now look what's happening in Europe. I mean, they're overwhelmed with their own sovereign debt problems now with millions of refugees.
Well, we're going to break. We'll come back and do 5 minutes on the other side and let you just focus in on a briefing, you know, as a former top economist in the White House on where you see this going. And I want to ask you when we come back that other key question. What does it signify that other central banks and now the Chinese are not buying as many U.S. treasuries? They're saying the economy's not as good as it was previously. I want to find out from you as an economist where you think the real state of the U.S. versus the global economy is and what you expect to come next. Dr. Paul Craig Roberts will do 5-6 minutes with us on the other side of the break. His website is paulcraigroberts.org. And then I'm going to get into a bunch of the election news, a bunch of the Europe news, Second Amendment news. It's all coming up. Stay with us. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Alex Jones Show. I am your host, Alex Jones. We are here live, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central now. We've added an hour. And, of course, we have the nightly news, 7 o'clock Central Standard Time. And as gloomy as some of what Dr. Roberts is talking about here, the good news is the world is waking up to the criminals that have basically occupied our government and taken it over. So I would say, in a way, the fact that the empire is in so much trouble is a positive thing. But looking at what's happening in the economy, how long can this QE go on? Dr. Roberts, what's the real state of the economy?
Well, it's in a shambles. There's really no economy here. It hasn't been for some time. You know, we've talked about it so many times. First, they offshored all the well-paid manufacturing jobs. Then they offshored millions of the professional skill jobs, the kind that are exchangeable, like software engineering, information technology. So we now have had several classes come out of universities, graduates, and there's no employment for them. And they can't form households. And they go back and live in their childhood rooms at home, or they go to their grandparents, or they pool what little resources they have from being waitresses and bartenders and the share rents. I mean, you know, you can't really have an economy if the young can't get a foot in. So there's no economy here. It's really it's really running on accumulated savings of the past, primarily those of the older generation, who are at the point where they have to help their children and their grandchildren. So there's no economy here. There are no jobs. The jobs are increasingly part-time, low-paid, no benefits. It's a shambles. If you don't have good connections, you can't get a job. Not one that would permit you to form a household and have an independent existence. And we can see this, Alex. You know, you have now the situation where there are all these young women who can't pay the student loans. They can't pay the college tuition, the car payments, the rents, and they advertise themselves that they're available to older men who have resources. So this is a sign of a third world country. The United States is a failed state in every respect. In every respect. There's no strength here anywhere except in these, in whatever this deep government is that's destroying the Constitution and everybody's rights. There's no other strength. And so the whole thing can just collapse out from under them. There's no strength in the West. There's no strength in Europe. The strength is in Russia and China. It's the only places in strength. And so we will try to destabilize those countries. As I said earlier, I think Putin is on due for an assassination attempt. And the United States now is discredited in the eyes of the world. It's discredited with its own vassals. I saw the other day that Australia, a total U.S. puppet state, total puppet, it refused to participate in the American naval operations in the South China Sea. So people are looking at this and saying, well, this doesn't work for us anymore. We don't want to be drawn into a conflict with Russia and China. The United States is no match for the combination of Russia and China. No matter what Obama was bragging about at the UN, we have the most powerful military, we have the most powerful economy. Balderdash. When Russia hit those Islamic State targets with those sea-launched cruise missiles from the Caspian Sea, that sent fear all up every European spine. No one knew they had these weapons. With these types of weapons, an anti-ballistic missile defense is worthless because it can't shoot down cruise missiles. Russia doesn't need ICBMs to take Europe out. Europeans know that. They have no protection whatsoever. If they're forced into conflict with Russia, they'll disappear instantly. They know that. So the whole thing has changed. I think the change came with Obama's speech on the 28th of September. He said, we've had it with you. That's it. 2 days later, as I said, he's taken over the war in Syria. What can we do about it? Nothing. Push the button. So I think the economy here is, there's no economy. It's not coming back. It's probably going to go down further. It could, something sharp could happen in which the whole thing just implodes, you know, like a controlled demolition of a building. Or it could just be a long, slow, drawn-out process where all the savings in the system are drawn out and people become progressively poorer year by year, except for the 1%, which sits there accumulating whatever surplus is left in the system. This doesn't work. It doesn't work. It can't work. It's ignored. All the real problems are ignored. And so they're not addressed. If they're not addressed, they can't be fixed. They fester. They get worse. They blow up. And the system breaks down. I think that that is the most accurate forecast of what's going to happen. In the meantime, yes, they may oppress all of us who speak out. They may well do that. You know, it's always been the tendency to shoot the messenger. Shoot the messenger. You're a messenger. I'm a messenger. Shoot them. And they've got the power to do that. Yes. So, but these are the risks you take. You know, I mean, if they can shoot you wherever you are. Where can you go? In fact, the way that the Americans are becoming hated all over the world, you're not safe anywhere. The people there will kill you. Where can you go? You could go to Russia if you learn the language. Probably you'd be safe there. But not necessarily. The CIA may send one of these Chechen terrorists after you. Americans aren't safe anywhere. It's not just that not safe from the own government. But, you know, if the CIA wants to get you, it's easier for them to kill you in Mexico than here.
That's right.
So, you know, the notion of getting out and getting away, you know, you can shut up, make an apology. But other than that, you're in it.
Oh, and, I know. I mean, I'm in it and I'm never leaving. I was just bemoaning.
Just remember that statement, you know, a coward dies many times, a brave man dies but once. That's a much better way to go.
Oh, I totally agree. And I pledge to stay here.
Don't worry about it. We're in a fight. Look, if you're in a war, you're going to be killed any minute. And you don't say, well, damn, I might be killed. I think I'll go home. You just, you got to fight. That's my view. So I think you need to keep telling people. You don't need to exaggerate. You don't need to go beyond the evidence. You don't need to go up the wall. You can just tell them the facts of what's going on and just come back to the two points I made. Look what Bush did. Look what Obama did. We can put you in indefinite detention despite the Constitution. We can murder you despite the Constitution. If you can do that, that's a police state. Putin can't do that. They can't even do that in China. Everybody is subject to law. But us, we've lost the protection of law. You know, that's the book I wrote those years ago, The Tyranny of Good Intentions. The title was How the Law Was Lost. And the publisher changed it. But we don't have the protection of law. And this began before 9/11, before the wars, before Obama and Bush. So if you don't have protection law, you don't have nothing. This is the fact. And by the way, my latest book is The Neoconservative Threat to World Order. That's the latest book. It's just out.
Clarity. Well, we need to have you back to talk about that book then. Briefly, I guess it just breaks down that the neocons are still in control.
Well, they may not be. I noticed one thing recently. It's optimistic. Obama was interviewed on 60 Minutes by some neocon or somebody whose mindset is neocon. And the guy was trying to push him into taking aggressive action in Syria. And Obama, at the very end, said, look, what do you want us to do? Repeat all the mistakes we've already made? More troops in Syria, more back to Iraq, troops in Libya, troops in Yemen? He said, it would be a shame if we can't learn from our mistakes and not repeat them. Now, that shows that he finally realizes after 7 years he's been a tool of a neocon agenda that he said has not served the national interest of the United States. I wrote about this. Go look at the interview, just the Syria part of the interview on 60 Minutes. It was very recent. I forget the guy's name.
It's 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, and I wrote about it just recently. And just go look at that interview toward the very end. This guy keeps trying to push Obama. It's all your fault the Russians are in Syria. You were weak. You wouldn't intervene hard enough. It's just like a neocon pushing him. And Obama says, no, we've made those mistakes, not anymore. Now, I think, and I wrote, I said, this is an amazing thing, because it's a very lonely and dangerous position for Obama to take. So what does it mean? You know, the president is always, people exaggerate the independence of a president. They don't have anything like the independence. People think, I know, I've worked for the president. I know how little independence even Reagan had. Obama hasn't any, and yet he made this statement. So it tells me he's realized that he's been used for 7 years, handed scripts, handed decisions, and they failed. And just go read it and see if that exactly says in the very end of the serious section, or just go straight to my column, which we'll reference it.
And that's at drpaulcraigroberts.org or paulcraigroberts.org. All right, well, very informative, and I guess it's good news in the bad news, but overall, I can see it on the streets. People are waking up, or they're just getting stupider.
Alex, remember, people will fight and resist if they think there's hope. So don't take away all the hope. Tell them what's going on. Encourage them.
I totally agree. I totally agree with you. But at the same time, I think people...
I'll come back, but I can't really ever do much more than 30 minutes. It's just hard.
I understand. All right, we'll talk to you again very soon. Congratulations on the new book, and thank you for joining us.
Good. It's always good to talk to you, Alex. All the best to you.
Thanks a lot. There goes Dr. Paul Craig Roberts. Smart guy, and he's been really pessimistic in the past. He seems more positive now. And I want to be clear. I'm not trying to be doom and gloom here. And I really don't exaggerate. What I find is 9 times out of 10, I don't. Sometimes I do. But when I go back and really listen to shows and things, I usually underestimate And I think that's all of our blind spot, is that people don't realize when they're facing real tyranny. The world still didn't know what Hitler was up to in 1939. There were debates in Newsweek magazine or Time magazine whether he was a good guy or a bad guy. Time Life books. Folks were debating, you know, whether the communists were good when Stalin was in power and already killed tens of millions. Folks weren't saying Mao was a mass murderer until the 70s. I mean, a lot of the conservatives were calling it Red China and criticizing it, knew what was going on, but we just have to admit how corrupt things have gotten. And they are starting to go after and indict senators and congressmen and women and governors. We're going to go to break, get Joe Biggs to pop in briefly at the Hillary event, see if there's new developments there. I'm sure there has been. He's gotten into the event. She's scheduled to be there in the next 15 minutes. We'll check in again with him in the next hour. But, you know, when Roberts, I'm going to get in an argument with him. He's a smart guy, but he's like, the UN's not taking over. That's our puppet. I get all that. But it's international law being adopted. Just like the gun treaty. They use that to come in then and basically apply it because of treaties we've already signed, just like TPP. So there is a method to this. America's meant to be brought down into the global system. Roberts just comes from a group of people that actually weren't perfect but wanted to build the country up. So for them, it's just really disgusting. And I get that. But we've got to admit how horrible it is to be able to get out of it. That's what's optimistic, is to admit that we're overrun. And to really break with the people that run Washington. I mean, you've got to understand, folks, that this isn't debatable, that this is going on. As he said, it is a fact. But I think it's good to be emotional about it and aggressive about it, because that's how you get people out of their trance. And I am physically upset. You know, when I say I instinctively want to evacuate the country, I could move out of the country and the globals would probably never even come after me. Or I could go to New Zealand, whatever. I'm never going to do that. It's funny, Robert's giving me a pep talk. Don't leave, you know, don't be positive, you're doing a good job. I'm not saying that. It's here watching the country be strangled in front of me and knowing that I'm in the crosshairs is a disgusting feeling, is what I'm saying. And in my flesh, in my gut, I just don't want to be in the middle of it. But I am, and I'm not leaving. But still, I have that thought. I'd be a liar if I didn't say I wasn't having that thought. By the way, Super Male Vitality, our number one flagship product of concentrated herbs and compounds, is now back in. You've heard the rave reviews. People have been chomping at the bit to get it. It is back in. It's been sold out for over a month. But now we can say that it is back in stock. The truck gets here Monday. Order today, and you'll be the first to get your shipment next week when the new limited supply hits our warehouse. This ultra-strength formula contains organic herbs and acids that are the real deal. Visit InfoWarsLife.com and order Super Male Vitality today before we sell out. We have Super Female Vitality back in as well. And the great part is your purchase funds this no-compromise hardcore operation. Also, we've got 20% off on Secret 12. We've got 10% off on storable food and free shipping on InfoWars Select and InfoWarsStore.com. That is a huge, biggest, that's just a giant special. Really high-quality storable food. It's what I and my family have. And we've also got 10% off and free shipping on ProPure G2 entire line of filters. InfoWarsStore.com is the general shopping cart. InfoWarsLife.com is the subsection with the nutraceuticals. InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right to the storable foods area. And we have the full spectrum of My Patriot as well. It's the same thing. It's just private label by us. We can offer lower prices. InfoWarsLife.com.